Here we will be discussing about APRV mode, airway pressure release ventilation. And as the name suggests, the airways are kept at a high pressure and they are allowed releases in between. And the higher pressures, the patient is allowed to breathe spontaneously. So you can consider it as a mode which keeps you at two different pressures at a very high period of time at the higher pressures and a very low period of time at the lower pressures and allows you to breathe spontaneously at those levels. When we set the APRV mode, we are asked four variables. Two pressures, the high and the low, two times, those spent at the high and at the low pressures. We generally, to begin with, allow something like 10 to 14 releases per minute. So you can also call them 10 to 14 breaths per minute. And with a rate of 12, let's say, one cycle is of around 5 seconds. We will partition that 4.5 seconds for inspiration and 0.5 seconds for expiration, or 4.5 at P high and 0.5 at P low. This is like an inverse ratio ventilation, where the ratio between the P high and the P low is generally 9 to 10 is to 1 to begin with. And then we manipulate it further as per our needs. Is this T low good enough to allow exhalation? Well, it's generally good enough because ARDS, there are non-compliant lung, and the expiratory flow constant of non-compliant lungs is actually high. So 5 minutes may be good enough to exhale and to bring down the carbon dioxide levels. The difference between the P high and the P low also determines the volume delivered with each releases. And we look for a target of something like 6 ml per kg body weight. There is a huge excursion because the P low is generally kept very low. Conventionally, it was 0 centimeters of water. So basically, if you consider it like PEEP, it's 0 PEEP. But nowadays, with the paper by Zhou published in Lancet in 2017, there is an interest in keeping it at positive number. So we can look for a P low of 5 centimeters of water to begin with. The difference between the high and the low would determine the tidal volume, which is totally a ventilator-assisted breath. So there is no effort of the patient. Whereas at the P high, a dynamic expiratory valve allows the patient to breathe spontaneously. So some amount of minute ventilation will be generated from the spontaneous breaths, and the other will be generated by the difference between the P high and the P low. And we can partition the two. So to begin with, we can allow 20 to 30% of all minute ventilation to be generated by patient efforts and the rest by the difference between the P high and the P low. At these efforts generated in the patient, it is desirable to have automatic tube compensation so they do not struggle with those bad stiff lungs to breathe. Otherwise, they will tire out. When we set the T low, we set an arbitrary number of 0.5 seconds to begin with, but you should have a look at the expiratory flow graph. The expiratory flow should not drop to more than 50% of the peak. And it is at that point we should abort the T low and start the new breath, or maybe limit the release to that amount and let the pressure rise again to P high. Because if we allow the flow to fall beyond that, then there is possibility of de-recruitment, and we know de-recruitment and re-recruitment will lead to greater lung injury. The T low may have to be manipulated sometimes to a higher level when we are not able to manage the carbon dioxide. But even for those values, the T low should not come down at least below 25% of the peak flow. But generally keep it at 50% and above as a point where the new breath should start. The P high determines the mean airway pressures along with the T high. So if you have higher pressures going on for longer periods of time, your oxygenation would improve. So you might go from 4.5 seconds to 5.5, 6, 7, 8, all depends on the particular patient, but this is what determines the oxygenation. And it also determines the functional residual volume is the lung has. So if the lung is filled to adequate FRC, the patients will not struggle to breathe at these higher pressures. So if the patients are struggling to breathe at the higher pressures, you may just increase the P high and look at the optimal level which is reached, which makes the patients comfortable. The P high will also require help in CO2 diffusion, something which we don't generally talk about in ventilation. We just talk about the time required for the release or the expiration. What happens here is the increased time allows the CO2 to diffuse from the pulmonary circulation into the alveoli, and then this can be released with every release which takes place. The pH and the TH together determines the MAP. So whenever you are manipulating, you may manipulate the other so that you are able to maintain good mean airway pressure, which is what helps us in oxygenation. When you are trying to take away the support, then what we generally do is we decrease the P high, but we increase the T high. So the releases become lesser. The patients take more and more spontaneous breath at these higher levels. And so now the work of breathing by the patient gradually increases. So at certain point of times, as we keep decreasing the pressure, the releases are very few, and it almost becomes like a CPAP mode where the patient is able to breathe spontaneously. At this point of time, maybe you can consider to switch over them to pressure support, but that depends. But if the strategy is working, we can actually wean off the patient totally in the APRV mode itself. This can be the mode with which you can start ventilating a difficult or severe ARDS, and in the same mode you can actually wean them off. So you may not have to switch over to another mode. The energies spent by the patient, if they are excessive at the higher pressures, may tire them out. So this is something that you should always look at. And the slower release time and the slower release rate may cause carbon dioxide retention. We got to make a good bargain between oxygen and carbon dioxide. For carbon dioxide, the first thing we do is raise the P high a little to get them at adequate functional residual volume so that they can breathe spontaneously well and blow off the carbon dioxide. You may have to increase the respiratory rate, or you can call them increase the releases, but that will always cause derecruitment and decrease the mean airway pressures. Or you can increase the T low, but always make sure that you do not fall tremendously in the expiratory flow curve, because that will cause derecruitment. So APRV allows higher mean airway pressures with an ability to control the carbon dioxide still, causes lesser lung injury because there are lesser breaths and lesser times of derecruitment. They allow a patient to breathe spontaneously, so you may not require sedation. Paralysis is out of question, because as soon as you paralyze them, it becomes a conventional inverse ratio ventilation. And these all may actually allow the patient to come out of the ventilator faster. And this was what was shown by the trial conducted by Zhao in 2017, which finds a publication in Lancet. I have shared that link in my video, and I strongly encourage to read, to get excited, and maybe choose your next patient for the APRV mode.